Ahoy, hoy. Hello, hello, hello. Good morning, everyone. So, let me get on the right slide. So, welcome, one and all. Welcome to another Friday morning, looking at the markets. See, there's still one or two people just rolling in and logging in for the moment, so I'll just give it a moment or three. How are we all doing? Nice to see our regular faces. Awesome. Right, okay, so we've given it a minute or three, I think. That's going to be it. I just see everyone's attempting to log in for the moment. Okay, so let's get officially started. Hello and welcome. Thank you for your time again on a Friday morning. It really is appreciated that you take a little bit of your time out of your day to spend it with little old me. Our usual agenda is we're going to take a little look at the markets. We're going to spend, you know, at least 20-30 minutes looking at the markets. We're going to link that into hunting versus fishing. I've been asked a few times recently about hunting versus fishing, farming versus fishing. There's different styles and approaches to finding trading opportunities. So that's what we're going to focus on. My primary focus at the moment is to basically wait for the setups to develop on a core list of stocks. That's what I might refer to as fishing. But what we can do if we so choose to, and it's one of those personal preference things, there's no right or wrong, but we can go hunting for opportunities and find them. So we're going to take a little look at hunting. Again, some people have been asking them. That's generally the approach that I'm using right now in very, very short-term trading, just to not worry about what's going to happen tomorrow. Because as you may have noticed, we're up a day, down a day, up a day, down a day. And that's pretty much what we've seen ahead of the elections and all the nonsense. And with all the other shenanigans, it's just really been magnified. So just looking for some short-term opportunities where I've been spending some of my attention. Again, we'll talk a little bit more about that later on. But that's essentially what we're going to be looking at. It's basically hunting for rocket stocks. Excuse my exaggeration, but if we can find them, great. We don't know that they're going to be rocket stocks, but we're going to try and essentially look for the footprints that give us the best suggestion that we're going to see some explosive moves. So if, again, I see there's one or two new faces, one or two old faces in the list of names. So if today is your first day, welcome to our little small but growing community. I'm not a Wall Street guru. The funny little backstory, just as a run, I've seen squirrels already today, folks, bear with me. I did have every intention of going to work in the city. That was the master plan way back in the late 90s. But back in, if you remember that far back, but 97, 98 was when things started to go digital. So I was quite literally bags packed on my way to the Big Smoke to seek fame and fortune in the UK equivalent of Wall Street. And quite literally that summer, Barclays Bank, Barclays Trade Desk more specifically, had got rid of 800 pit traders because that's when the trading pits started to close down and it all went digital. So my dreams of living it up in the Big Smoke went up in smoke. So just a little random thing. So I tried to, but I didn't quite make it there. On the different tangents, I did figure it out. I managed to kind of crack the code. I did make my mark on the markets, but I had to do it the hard way. I had no one really to guide me or point me off in the right direction. So I did what everyone else did. I figured it out on my own and I essentially cracked the code. These days, I'm probably what most people would class as a lifestyle trader. I do like to spend most of my days doing whatever the hell I get to choose. Part of that is to tinker with the markets, but most of my days, usually my morning, which is what I've done again, I met up with some friends in my local coffee shop, or well, one or two friends in my social bubble, I might like to add. So it's perfectly okay. Spending my time reading a book, drinking good coffee or bad coffee, depending on the barrister, and just enjoying my day. day. I spend probably about 60 to 90 minutes tinkering with the markets. Officially, unofficially, I'll be doing other research bits around that. My backstory, just to give you the it's not my first day doing this. I've been trading full-time since 2001. Hand-drawing shots since the early 90s, call most of my trades out in real time since 2004. The most part is mainly due to the fact that some of the trades are very, very short-term, very fast at the moment, and it's just not practical to call them out in real time. But I do everything that I can do to do everything in real time. Anyway, my big obsession with trading, I'm absolutely passionate about it, is to help you see your own success. I don't want to create a clone. I do want to help you create your measure of success with trading. Again, I've got systems and processes that are replicatable, and it's just turning the knobs and dials to make sure that you can essentially copy the success that I see from the markets using a systematic approach to find, filter, and sort opportunities. And that's generally the what we're trying to do every week here is just kind of show you a systematic way to approach the markets. Just like with any business, all good businesses have a system, they have a process, and that's what we're going to look at right now. So with that said, let's take a look at the markets. And thinking about the systematic approach, just my own evolution of the process. Again, I often refer to a production line, but the first step is mechanical. The second step is visual. So what I mean by that is the mechanical we do over here in the watch list, this is often what we do. We're looking for, like this yellow block here, you know, it's referencing some indicators over here. So if we were to look for a new mechanical condition, I'm expecting to see a certain thing. So right now, the Dow, this is Dow Futures, it's giving me a reading in the bottom 20% of its rolling range. So that's the mechanical condition. That's a condition that I'm looking for. I'm interested in that. So that when I go to, let's take a look at this one. We got the red bear here, and we've got a little one. It fired off yesterday, but I've got this bearish condition, and that's what it's telling me. Let me just tidy up. So that there is what we're seeing there. So that's what it's telling me. So I can do that mechanical scan. So step number one is mechanical. What am I looking for? Has a condition been met that I'm interested in? So all it's telling me is that, hey, price over the last 30 days, 30 bars, because this is percentage R, the tool. You could use stochastic, you could use a different type of oscillator. They all kind of vary on the same thing. Percentage R, clues in the name, the percentage R, the percentage range, that's all it's telling you. We're in the bottom 20% of its rolling range. That's it, that's all it's doing. It's nothing clever, it's nothing fancy, it's nothing mystical. It doesn't generate signals, but it tells me something that I'm interested in. That's all it's telling me. But it's doing all of that on the left here. So now I know that, I can start to build a picture in my mind. And then the second step of our mechanical production line is visual. Now we're already looking at this so I can explain the process, but the next step is visual. That's when I would then click on the charts to have a visual inspection. And what I'm expecting to see is, because we're in the bottom 20% of its rolling range, I'm expecting to see one of two things. Either price is retracing in the context of an uptrend, or we are at the lower end of an actual consolidation. So one of two things. Again, remember, price is either going up, it's going down, or it's going sideways. There's only three things the market or a market can do. So I'm looking to see if it fits into one of those three things. So mechanically, we're in the bottom 20%. It's probably retracing if we're in an uptrend, or we're at a range low, or maybe we're below the range. Maybe we're breaking down and out. So that's what I'm looking for. I'm looking to try and figure out where are we in the context of the chart. Because when I know what the trend is, from the visual inspection, I can start buying the dips, selling the rallies, you know, buying range lows, selling range highs, you know, all those things, those six things that we like to do. And it just means that I can mechanically scan. I'm going to use M again. I can do the visual scan. And all I'm doing with the visual is confirming what the mechanical scan was suggesting, So when we know these things, it just helps us to build a structure, build a framework. And, you know, I can zoom into the stocks, the charts that make the most sense. So if I go to my regular stock list, so what I would do here, so that column there is looking at this indicator here. So all I would look for is, do I have a yellow indication? That's going to be a brand new indication. So there's one, two, three stocks for me to potentially look at. And again, bear in mind, I've not looked at them yet. So then I want to look left. I've got the center column is going to help me figure out what the trend is. So if we've got a bear indication there, so we're in the bottom 20% of the rolling range on, is it Papa John's pizza? I was going to say Pizza Express, but it's the ticker PZZZA, Papa John's. So I've got a bear indication there, but I've got a little bit of a mixed indication. So we, you know, from previous weeks, we know that these are referencing the moving averages. Are we above or below the moving averages? So there's a little bit of conflict there. So I'm probably expecting to see either a deep retracement or a consolidation. So when we go and look at that chart, I can start to build in that picture. So we're at the bottom 20% of the rolling range. It has been trending visually. We can see that the average prices are pointing upwards, but we've got that deeper retracement. Now we're between the moving averages, which is what we have here. We've got we've got red, red, blue. So we're below the moving averages and above some of the others. So it's just telling me that, you know what, there's a little bit of conflict. Maybe I don't worry about that one. Maybe I come back tomorrow and don't worry about it. For this, what I'd like to see is for price to be above the 50 period moving average, above the 200. We're already in the average prices, the uptrend. So there's that mechanical scan. That's what I'd want to see here. So I'd be looking for blue, 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 just like BYD here. You know, it's blue, blue, blue. And then if I saw a brand new bullish indication in that column there, then that would be really, you know, a better candidate. So that's what I'm looking for. So that's what these scans are. That's what a production line should do for me. And as usual, it takes longer to explain than to actually do. But nonetheless, it's going to speed up the process. And this is what allows me to zoom into the stocks that are, maybe I'm not necessarily trading today, but I'm certainly going to look at them today. And then I'm trying to figure out, am I going to trade it? Is it today or not today? Is it today or not today? So then I'm looking for that, you know, the step number three is there an entry? Two, three. So there we go. So we've got mechanical, we've got visual, and then we've got entry. So I'm looking for an entry pattern, you know, in my little production line, you know, is it today or not today? Again, it's not no. It's just not today. And I've already said, I'd like to see price above the 50 period moving average to suggest that price is moving higher. If it was already above the moving average, then I'm going to look for one of my fancy little reversal pullbacks or those V-shaped patterns. So let's see if we can find an indication here. So let's check out BYD. So BYD. So I've gone on to BYD here. We've got blue, blue, blue. So I know that we're above the 50, above the 200, and the average prices are pointing upwards. That's what we're expecting. So there's the average price crossed above the 200, above the 50. And this time I've got a little bit of a spike on the candle. So a slightly different scan here. Don't have the bottom 20% of the rolling range, but I do have a little indication to say, you know what, yesterday's candle has got a little bit of a wick. It's got a little bit of a spike on it. So that's what this column's telling me. So I've got a few different ways of finding these scans, but if I'm looking to buy the dip in an uptrend, then, well, let's throw it open. What do you think? Now that we're looking at this chart, do we have a mechanical trend? Yes. Do we have a visual trend? Yes. Do we have an uptrend? Well, that's what we've just found. So is price retracing in the context of an uptrend? So let's throw it open. Do we have a retracement in the context of that uptrend? Do we have a retrace? Just give me a little yes or a no in the chat box. Do we have a retracement in the context of an uptrend? I know it was a very leading question. I know. So yeah, we do. But this is what we're looking for. But we can do most of the heavy lifting over here on the left. So that's essentially what we're trying to do with the premise. And this is what I was talking about at the beginning, where this is like fishing. I'm waiting for the setup. I'm waiting on the canal bank, the ponds, the river, you know, wherever we're fishing. We're waiting for the fish to get hungry, and we're waiting for the fish to kind of, you know, bite, essentially. That's what the idea of fishing. We're waiting for the fish to start feeding. And, you know, and this is the analogy that I use with the stocks. I'm waiting for the setup. So this is what buy the dip in an uptrend looks like. And it's just very simply waiting for the opportunity to get involved. So then the next question. So step number three is So we've got mechanical, visual. Oops, I don't know why I'm suddenly dyslexic with writing today, but nevertheless. Mechanical, visual, and then entry. So we want to buy the dip in an uptrend. So then the question is it today or not today? I'm looking for one of three things. So I've got my little entry checklist. Is it today or not today? And as price is retracing, it's not necessarily, it's yes. Yes, there is a trade, but is it today? So I'm looking for one of three things. I got three choices. I can trade aggressively that exhaustion bar that we see right now, which I'm not inclined to do at the moment, just the way that things are. I can look for that exhaustion bar. So as price goes above that high, the exhaustion bar high, I can say, you know what, that is, there's my adventurous entry, for want of a better description, and place the trade. Game on. So that's, you know, the earliest time that I would place the trade. And then the second choice is to wait for price to move on the daily chart and then retrace again. Remember that V-shaped pattern that we keep talking about? Again, we've got an example of it there. We've got the rally, the retracements. You know, we've got a rally, retrace. We've got those V-shaped patterns. We can wait for price to rally, retrace, create that V-shaped pattern, and then trade the break of the apex. That's what we can do there. So there's the second choice, the intermediate setup. And then the absolute conservative is when price goes above that high there, the pullback high, I can take my trade there. So I've got three choices, a little bit more adventurous, intermediate. The second one's the one that I usually take at the moment and have done for about the last 12 to 18 months. Or we can trade that break of the pullback high. I would only refine the entry with the second choice that I mentioned. If there's a deeper retracement, if the opportunity is there to do it, it's not always there. So if you don't get the deep retracements, then it's going to be the third choice, the more conservative entry, the break to a new high. So a small retracement is there, break to a new high, and that will get you in, and there's your choices there. So you've got the mechanical, the visual confirmation, mechanical trend, visual trend, and then you've got your entry checklist. And this is what we should be doing, you know, all the time. The first one, certainly, you know, can we find an opportunity over here on the left, doing all the heavy lifting in the watch list so that we can find a good trade? So that's fishing. We're waiting for fishing. So that's fishing. So that's waiting for that opportunity, waiting for the opportunity. So you're just waiting for the fish to bite, and that's what that entails. So I think that segues nicely into I'm kind of talking about our hunting for rocket stocks. Now, we know what fishing is. I'm kind of doing it backwards, folks. I know I promised you to look at the markets. They're not really doing anything. I'm not planning on doing anything ahead of Tuesday's election. There's no major change from the last few points. But nonetheless, so hunting for rocket stocks, I think we've ended up kind of jumping straight into it, which is, there was reason for going through it a little bit faster, a little bit earlier, because I actually want to hunt for a rocket stock ready for later today. So one of the things that I can do to hunt for rocket stocks is prior to the market opening. And what I've got over here, I've got my kind of large list of about 300 stocks, my old list of 300 stocks more specifically. And what I can do is I can find out, okay, well, what's moving pre-market? Because these are all the live price. We've got about 10 minutes before the market opens. I'd normally do this about 20, 30 minutes before the market opens. And this is a hunting scan. How do I go and find stocks that are explosive? How do I find stocks that are explosive? So that's that hunting for rocket stocks. So we've just looked at farming. Now I want to look at fishing. We've looked at fishing. Now I want to look for rocket stocks. My apologies. So I can go hunting for those opportunities. And very simply, I can start to match up. Okay, well, what stocks are moving? What stocks are moving? And all I'm going to do is sort all the stocks by net change. And I can do that as a percentage, or I can do it by dollar amount. No right or wrong way here, but I've got my preferred list of stocks, things that are liquids. They've got options that I can trade. And I'm just looking for something that is explosive. Now, I've also got in this column here, earnings. So I can see that Twitter has had a news event yesterday. And I can also, I'm not actually sure this should be live. I think I've got a little bit of a glitch with my TradeStation. It doesn't look like it's updating. But what should happen is I should get pre-market volume as well. I should get pre-market volume. So I'm able to make some evaluations. But what I can see is that Twitter, and again, I've not looked at the chart. We've got a different chart. I'm doing the scan. I can see that we've had earnings, news events. So I've got the opportunity for explosive movements. It's already happened. It's going to gap down 15% nearly. So it's gapping 15%. And on Twitter, which is $50 stock, that's a good dollar movement. So that could be a good candidate. Again, looking at the volume, I'm not sure this is updating. I'm not seeing any. Normally, you'd see these numbers move. And it's a little bit frustrating because I do have it set to update in real time. So I just think I've got a little bit of a glitch on my data at the moment. Again, TradeStation's just being a pain in the bum. So let's go and take a look at it. What we should be seeing, again, we're not seeing it there. So you'll have to look at it your chart. What we would potentially see is, again, a big number. You'll see that number is active. That would be today's live pre-market volume. And then I would just compare it to, well, what's the average? What's the average volume? And I can see if there's a good chunk of activity in the last 20, 30 minutes, maybe the last hour of trading. That would be interesting. So Twitter is looking great. Now, what I can also do, again, I'm not clicked on the chart yet, so don't look at the chart. I'm doing all the heavy lifting over here on the watch list. I'm just showing you a hunting scan. So I'm going to highlight the 60-minute chart. And this time, I'm going to add in pre-market data. So US data with pre-markets. So I can actually see what the pre-market data looks like. So now let's go and look at Twitter. And what you'll see, it's on the 60-minute chart. But what you'll see is it's a little bit shaded differently, but there's that gap. So what we have, if you didn't already know this, but stocks are traded pre-markets anywhere from 30 to 90 minutes before the market opens. There is trading activity. And you would also see post-market data. So there's about a 30 or so minute window after the official market has closed where there is trading activity. And if this is new information for you, hopefully you're falling off the chair so we can get a little bit of a clue as to what is happening and what is going on. I think what I'll do is I'll take my usual tools off here and I'll put the volume on. Take that off and let's put volume average. Again, I'm just not seeing it. I'm not convinced that that is updating properly, but there we go. What can we do about it? So I've got actual volume there. So what I would be looking to see is, and I'm surprised there isn't, which just highlights that I think I've got a little bit of a data issue, is that we should be looking at a little bit of a spike in volume. The reason why I'm looking for spike in pre-market volume as well is it lets me know that there may be activity, specifically institutional activity, because they're typically the people who move and influence the markets, and they can trade at high volumes. So that's what I'd be looking for here. So I'd be looking for, 50,000 plus, maybe there's 100,000 plus, maybe there's 500,000, maybe there's 5 million traded in the pre-markets because of the news. And I know that the average is 17 million shares. So if I see that they're, on the news events, We've got a gap in price, so it's a news-driven explosive movement, and we've got volume, 100,000, 50,000, you know, on a stock like Twitter, maybe 100,000 shares traded in the pre-market in the last hour. That's not necessarily an unrealistic thing to see. It's just a shame I can't show you what it actually is. I really think there's a little bit of a glitch with my data at the moment. Nothing a reset or a reboot won't fix, but obviously we don't have time for that right this moment. So that's what I'd be looking for here. So this is something that I can say, you know what, this looks interesting. You know, this looks like a great candidate for me to consider adding to my shortlist. So I would pop that over on my Apple Peeler tab, which I've already done. And I've got a few stocks that I like to look at for fast morning explosive movements. Because I've already said I'm looking for very short-term trading. I'm looking for setups that develop in the first 20 to 30 minutes of the day. I'm looking for those candidates beyond, again, these are the stocks that are on my usual watch list, but then I've also got some extra ones because there's some maybe news events. We're in earnings season. So every 3 months we have a lot of stocks that are all clustered together that have these types of known events. Now, it could also be, it doesn't necessarily have to be a news thing, but there could also be like an announcement, a product announcement, corporate announcements. There could be some negative news comes out. But, you know, we get this information. We can see how the market reacts, specifically the institutional traders, how they feel and are reacting about these moves. So I get to see all of this information. Again, let's just resort them. So I've got the about 3 minutes before the market opens. So we've got as much data. So I've got a lot of stocks that are gapping. The other thing that I like to do, if you want to look at the percentage change, or I've just resorted them by percentage change, and you can cut them off by saying, okay, anything more than 2% is going to give you a shortlist. So you've only got 20 stocks really that are most interesting out of all these stocks. So it's not many stocks is the point. So there's a lot of stocks that are moving because the market's down heavy again today, as we know. So which ones are moving the most? So you can look at that. Are they above or below 2% of the underlying? Or you can look at the biggest dollar movers, the biggest dollar gainers. So let's sort it the other way. There are some bullish stocks today. So we've got relative strength against the market. So again, the one that catches my attention is Deckers. You know, we've got earnings announcements. We've got, again, it's up 4%. And let's just go and take a look at the market. The market as a whole is down nearly 1%. So we've got huge relative strength. So this could be a really good candidate. So when I'm looking at this stock, again, it's going to be gapping to 267. So 267 is all the way up here. So I'm looking at the 60-minute chart. I'm looking at the daily there. We've got this nice rally retrace. Look at that rally retracement, rally retracement. You know, if we were swing trading, that's the sort of thing that we were looking for. But it's going to gap above this short-term consolidation or this retracement. So this could be a really good gap and go strategy or gap and go stock. It's going to gap above the range, this pullback high here. And that could trigger a lot of traders in, new money, not just new retail traders, but maybe new institutional traders. So that could be interesting. Does everyone see how this scan is working? We're looking for, you know, what are potentially some rocket stocks? It's already moving in the pre-market. It's already had a, you know, a liftoff, you know, and is there going to be that meteoric rush run into, you know, the atmosphere, into orbit? You know, and it's the same thing with the stocks that are moving lower. You know, there could be some interesting stocks. We're off. We're off. It's official. There we go. So see how volume's just reset. So let's just quickly do it. We've got the opening volume. So I want to go back to Twitter. There we go. So we've had three with it. Normally that would happen in real time. You'd see that before the market opens. We've had 3 million shares traded in Twitter pre-market, and we've just had the opening bell. So normal is about 17.5 million. The average there is 17.5 million. So we've had a good chunk of the day's activity on Twitter happen in the pre-markets. So, and you can see now that we've opened up, it's not necessarily out the gate running. So what I would be looking for is the same thing. We've got our gap. So mechanical direction is suggesting a downward movement. So then visual is next. I want to see price run lower. Again, this is where I can drop on. This is where I can jump over to my Apple Peeler strategy setup and look for these things. Again, we went through this strategy in more detail on a previous workshop. So you can refer back to the previous workshop from a couple of weeks ago. But mechanically, the scan is gapping with volume. There we go. Gapping with volume. That's looking great. Visually, I want to see price run in the same direction. You could also trade it counter trend for the gap fill. It doesn't really matter as such, but we're looking for those gap and goes. Why is Twitter looking interesting for a bearish move down? So looking at the daily chart, can you see that it was rally, 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 and now it's gapped lower? So anyone who got long, you know, on this run up, on this trending stock, they're probably shitting the bed right now. It's gone past prior swing lows, prior support, one level of support, two levels of support. So looking down and left, where could this get to? The next level of support down, you know, we've got a little bit of a one there, but we've got the possibility for, you know, if it goes there, a $2 move and maybe down to $40. So maybe a $2 to $4 move down. So I'm just looking down and left. There's the potential. Just simply, you know, where did price stop previously? So this could be interesting. So this is why it's on my little shortlist. Let's just see anything else catching my attention. Again, Facebook is gapping lower. We've got a little bit of volume there. Nothing really too much to get excited about with Facebook. And we've got a gap, but not a huge gap. Let me go back to my Apple Peel app because I've already done this ahead of our session today. Just want to try and give you some real-time excitement, if you like, rather than just do it all coulda, woulda, shoulda type scenario. So we've got Twitter, I've got Shaq, I've got Deck as my kind of three shortlisted extra stocks. I've got the stocks that I like to look at on a regular basis. Apple, obviously, which is what this strategy is named after, the Apple Peeler. You know, there's always going to be one stock that's always good to trade. But we've got some interesting stocks. The market is down 0.1%, Q's down 0.6%, Apple's down 0.3%. So we've got relative weakness. So Apple might be a good gap and go as well. Microsoft is in line with the broad markets. So although we've had recent earnings, it's not really doing anything out of the ordinary. Facebook is outperforming the market. We're down 2.5%. So that could be an interesting candidate today. Nvidia had a weak setup yesterday, but it's showing, again, a little, not much relative weakness compared to the market. Again, I'm just looking at the numbers here, comparing the percentage change, just like we do with the main markets when we're usually looking at the main index, trying to have an overall evaluation of the environments. So I'm just comparing the markets with the individual stocks and seeing which one's stronger, which one's weaker. IBM's gone a little bit stronger. Great. So that's okay. So I can kind of zoom into which ones am I going to look at first. Again, this takes longer to explain than to actually do. Again, I'm not looking at the chart yet. I'm still just looking at these percentage movements here. So we've got Twitter on the shortlist. It's down 15%. It's not really moving. That is the chart on the screen there. So we've got the big charts, 5-minute charts. Now, what I might want to do is just pop the 5-minute charts on the and have a look at the pre-markets, and maybe we have a look at the post-market. So let's put pre and post-market on there. Sometimes what we can do is we can get clues from the pre-market trading activity. So now that we've got the pre, can everyone see this? It's a little bit darkly shaded. So let me just draw it. That is where the bulk of the overnight trading activity, and then that's yesterday. And this here is, oops, can't draw a straight line here. So that's post-market yesterday, and this is pre-market today. So now that I've highlighted it, just in case you can't see it, can everyone see what I see? What do you see? We can see we've got a big trending move down. Can you see that? And we've got right here a consolidation at the end of the post-market trading yesterday and the start of the pre-market today. Can everyone see this consolidation? Give me a little yes or a hell yes or a, oh, I see where you're going, Phil. I see where you're going with this. Okay, what do we know about ranges? It's the same process on the chart. If we want to do a little bit of extra, is this a good opportunity? When do I get involved? Mechanically, we've done the scan. We've got the gap, pre-market volume. That's why we're looking at Twitter. Visually, step two, same production line process. Visually, what do we see? We've got trend yesterday, consolidation. What do we know about consolidations, folks? We can trade the range. 5-minute charts, probably not going to do that. Or we can wait for the breakouts. What do you think? Wait for the breakouts. As we're looking at this, would this range high is at $45. This range low is at $43. Should we just trade the breakouts? Now, I was favoring my opinion. Again, looking at the 60s, we've broken through those support levels. But now that we're looking at the 60s, it looks like it's coming back above that support level over here. So it's not gapping and going, is it? It looks like it's having a little bit of a rally. Now, we'll find out whether that's going to be sustained. It could still gap and go. But now that I've got my line in the sand, I've got a recognizable pattern. I can say, you know what? If it goes below $43, I'm going to trade the next pullback, the gap and the go. If it goes above the range, so if it goes above approximately 45, I could trade it counter trend if I wanted to. I'm not necessarily going to expect a gap fill, but it could move higher. So I can trade the pullback if I want to counter. Now, I like to go in the direction of the gap personally, personal preference. So for me personally, I would trade the direction of the gap and I would wait for the break of $43 and I would look for that push lower. And that's one way that we can go hunting for opportunities and see if we have a nice trending opportunity. So I'm still waiting for the setup. So the entry, the E part, visually, I've got my mechanical we've done. That's why we're looking at this stock. Visual, we've got what we actually see is actually happening. So those two things are lining up quite nicely. So now we've just worked out what needs to happen next for an entry. What needs to happen next for an entry. So I'm waiting for price to fulfill my prophecy. I'm waiting for it to push lower, retrace on the 5-minute chart, and then set up my pullback. So that's what I'm looking for to develop right there. So back to waiting. Will it or won't it set up? It's either going to be there or it's not there. There or it's not there. So this is how we can hunt for opportunities. Again, the setup's not right now. Again, I'm on a 5-minute chart, so I'm just waiting for that to set up. So what we can start doing is let's go look at Shake Shack. Shake Shack was gapping higher. Now that we've got the market open, can everyone see this? Shake Shack was gapping higher. Again, let's look at this on the 60-minute chart. It was initially doing, my apologies, gapping lower. I don't know why I said higher. So it's gapped lower, but eventually it's not gone any lower than that prior day. It's not doing anything new is how we would normally phrase that. So you know what? I'm going to take that off my list. I don't think it's worth worrying about. So come back tomorrow. So now that we've had a look at that, let's take a look at Deckers. Now, Deckers was the one that was gapping higher. We were looking at that on the daily chart, if you remember, to go above the range. Now that we've got that, again, pre-markets, it was looking like 267. So eventually it's gapped closer to not very much, actually. It's post or now that the market's open, it's still inside the middle of this consolidation. So again, not doing anything that's exciting me. So pre-market, we found a stock that was looking interesting. We hunted. And now that we've got the mechanical scan visually, we're not seeing it confirmed. So I can take that off my list. So it turns out that Twitter, out of those three extra stocks that I found, this is the one that's most interesting. So guess what we're going to do? We're going to very boringly wait for an opportunity. I can go and check my other stocks because, again, Apple was having a little bit of a run. Now that we're looking at Apple, can everyone see that we've got this same consolidation? We've got a, you know, kind of two layers on it. So I'd want to see price push and develop the pullback in the same way. It's not doing it just yet. So maybe I wait until it's moved out of this consolidation. So this is where having the advantage of looking for some pre or looking at some pre-market data, you know, maybe there's a push and a pullback that happens quite quickly. But by looking at the pre-market data, I can say, you know what, I need it to go below 110 maybe. Maybe you want to wait for it to go through yesterday's post-market action. But whatever your line in the sand is, I think it's fair to say that if that was to happen, then that's going to bring in some fresh selling pressure in this case. From a buying point of view, yes, it made a little bit of a high, but looking left across the chart, it's not really gone above that high there. So if we're going to trade this bullish, then above 212 would be looking great. Can everyone see this? Is this making sense? I'm just kind of showing you how I'm seeing the chart, giving you a little bit of a verbal commentary onto the scary thought of the inner workings of Phil's mind. Microsoft, as we suspected, not really doing anything that is looking exciting. It was showing, you know, it was moving in line relatively to the main markets, so nothing extraordinary. IBM is big bullish, 1.3%, compared to the rest of the markets, which are down small. So maybe IBM showing some relative strength. We're already up a dollar and a half. Look at her go. So Microsoft, my apologies, IBM. IBM's been really interesting. We've seen some great downtrends, gap and runs. And now we're going, you know, technically counter trend looking at the 60-minute charts, but we've gone above yesterday's high. So that's interesting for me. No significant pre or post-market data, not necessarily a bad thing, but we are definitely above yesterday's high. We've got a nice trend. So we've got a thrust move, we've got trending move. So the mechanical scan here is it's on my watch list. So it's one of those stocks that regularly moves and ebbs and flows quite nicely. So the mechanical scan, it's in my watch list. The other element to this is it's above the VWAP, if you want to be mechanical. So I'm going to be biased bullish because I'm above the volume weighted average price. I've got a nice visual thrust. I've got trending price action. It goes above yesterday's high, which is right there. Technically, it was to be counter trend for short term day trades, not necessarily a bad thing. So all I'm waiting for is my entry. Waiting for the entry. So I'm looking for price to retrace, and I'm looking for that retracement to get on board. So IBM's looking good, liking the look of it, showing a lot of strength relative to the market weakness. Facebook could be interesting. It ain't showing a lot more weakness relative to the markets. So that could be a good down move. Now that we're looking at Facebook, pre-market, post-market consolidation. So I'd like to see it go below about, what are we, two set? Well, there we go. It's doing it right now. So I'd like to see it push through that consolidation, which is what we've just done. So we're below the VWAP. So mechanically and bearish. Visually, it's starting to trend. Great. They're lining up. So now it's waiting for the entry. I'm looking for it to continue to move lower, develop a pullback that will provide me with my entry. Nothing to do just yet. Waiting for the setup. Let's check out Nvidia. Nvidia is down big, 2%. Again, pre-market, not really seeing anything exciting on the pre-market to stress over. Below the VWAP, bearish, mechanical. Visually, we can see prices moving lower. So that's looking good. So I want to see price confirm the direction for me. And then should it happen, I can trade the next pull back. So that's essentially it. Let's go back to Twitter. I think everyone agrees. I see there's a few comments. Cheers, Anthony. Twitter, would everyone agree that Twitter by far is still, it's kind of a toss-up between Apple and Twitter? They're the two best looking charts based on what we've seen so far. Would everyone concur? Does everyone kind of see what I see? They're the two best looking charts. So despite the fact that we're essentially day trading, we don't have to be gung-ho. We can just zero in on, okay, one or two trades. And for me personally, at 10 o'clock, so I've got another 15 minutes to wait for the possible entry setup. Again, we already know what I'm looking for. We've got the mechanical, we've got the visual, we're waiting for the entry. And that entry can take, 15 to 20 minutes to develop. Because again, I'm looking for a push in price, trending price, and I'm looking for a pullback. And for the moment, Twitter's not quite doing it. It's not broken through the $43. So that's what it needs to do first. Again, just layering on a little bit of visual discretion, just taking a very basic mechanical strategy, just adding an extra layer. But it's looking like it's a choice between two stocks for the moment. It's looking like a choice between two stocks. It doesn't mean that they're the only stocks that are available. We could go and find several other candidates. But if this is a new concept for you, what you don't want to do is overload yourself. Just find two or three candidates. You can stick with the universe, the core universe. I've got five stocks here that are just my core stocks that I'm going to look at every day. Is the setup there? It's either there or not there. And then we can look for gapping stocks. We can go hunting for those opportunities that make the most sense. We found Twitter. Twitter was by far the best looking candidate. Again, we could have spent a little bit of extra time. I was just having a little bit of an issue with my data, as you noted earlier. So that just prevented from looking for something that jumped out from a volume point of view. So we weren't able to fulfill the scan fully. Oops, everything falls off my desk. But nonetheless, I'm sure you can agree that this is a very simple production line process to look for and hunt for opportunities. I should have called this the hunt for Red October, shouldn't I? Have a little movie callback. But there we go. We've got the hunt for a good candidate. So now what I want to do, I think it's fair to say that we've got two candidates. We'll find out if they start to move. Apple's certainly looking like it's starting to move. Let's just quickly do a round robin. We've got Microsoft not really looking great. Three candidates. IBM, my apologies. I completely forgot about IBM. So we've got Apple. We've got IBM. And we've got Twitter. So that's the sort of thing that we're looking for. We've got the trend. The pullback is developing. Entry above the pullback high. If price goes below the VWAP, cancel the trade, because I'm looking for that strength to remain. And all you're looking for is a quick momentum movement. You're looking for something like that, a momentum move. You want to be green bar, green bar, green bar. That's what we're looking for to happen next. We're just looking for that momentum type of movements in the case of IBM. In the case of Twitter, looking for that same thing, looking for a momentum move, looking for a price to move directionally. And trade should last 20, 30 minutes. Shouldn't be, it's not an all-day trade. It's just a very quick in and out type of trade. Again, Apple's looking like it's going to set up. We've got that directional movement. So the visual part is confirming. Not yet below the pre-market and post-market data. We're certainly below the pre-market, but not below yesterday's post-markets. So maybe we want to wait for that. Maybe that boundary low, that's what creates the pullback. So it might pull back at $109. We'll find out. We'll find out shortly. So that's what I'm looking at today, folks. So you've got a little look over my shoulder. I'm doing some short-term trading today, as you can probably gather, but just doing a little bit of my preparation work so that you can get a flavor for what I is doing. So the hunt for rocket stocks, that's what we've looked at today. It's a very easy process. That hunting for the stocks is a part of the it's actually included in the day trading gapping stocks strategy that we have. So that's again basically a self-contained strategy that we can use. What we did today was I actually fused it together with the VWAP strategy, because again, the VWAP strategy primarily just looks at a core list of stocks. So I'm going to look at five stocks. There we go. I'm going to look at five stocks. Five stocks, the names don't really matter. You just want something that's liquid. It moves. You can get a good price. But you've got a core list of stocks. So if you just want to have one or two trades a week, if time is precious for you, like it is for me, you just want to be able to log in. And again, in 10 minutes time at 10 a.m. Eastern, just basically go, is the setup there or not there? And it's looking like it's going to be there on Apple. You know, we've got a nice direction. We've got a gap. Lovely. We've got a nice directional movement. And again, just waiting for it to develop. Perfect, Duncan. Let's go back to IBM. So you've got that same type of setup. That's what it looks like. There's the pullback. So entry above the pullback bar right there. So there's never, it looks like it's going to void quite quickly, actually. What you can't see is I've got my VWAP set as dots. If it closes below the VWAP line, so $109.70, I'm going to cancel that trade, because I'm looking for I'm looking for it to remain strong. So like we see over here yesterday, you can see that we've got that same pattern. You've got the pullback, and then here it closes below the VWAP line. So if the same thing happens again, then I'm not going to place that trade. I'm going to cancel the trade. So yeah, entry with the ports. That's looking great. That's exactly what we want. And again, we want a nice, fast, directional movement. And we'll see if we get that. So that's the VWAP strategy. We combined it today with hunting for some extra opportunities, because I found very little this week. There's been very little action, if I'm going to be honest, on just those five core stocks that I usually look at. Again, we went through the strategy overview a few weeks ago, and there seems to be quite a lot of interest. So I thought I would flesh it out, taking a few elements from the day trade program, just to go and find and hunt for a few extra opportunities. But this is how we can trade in the first 20 to 30 minutes. I mean, the first 20 minutes that we've just been through to explain the strategy, the setup, and what we're looking for, you know, we don't necessarily need to do that. I mean, if you're just looking at your five core stocks on a daily basis, it's at 10 a.m., check for the setup. So IBM, it's there or not there. It's already there. So it's pop the trade on and, you know, come back half an hour later to see if you've got a profit or a loss. You know, it's quite literally a 20 to 30 minute setup and then a 20 to 30 minute in trade experience. And if it doesn't trigger the trade, then you come back tomorrow, or in this case, Monday. But that's what we're doing with the VWAP strategy. So I'm sorry, folks, it's going to be as usual. If you want some extra help with it, I mean, to be fair, most people, if you get everything you needed from this overview, that's great. And the recording of this will be in our Slack community. So if you want to rewatch it, you can do. But if you need some extra help to find stocks so you can profit from these really short-term explosive movements, like the IBM trade, which I'm going to place as soon as I've finished in a few minutes, and you want to learn it in the smartest possible way and just focus on those best stocks and the best times to trade, because there's two or three patterns that we can use. I've shown you one simple pattern today. There's actually three versions of the same pattern if you want. We can go through the TTE trade management system, which just stands for timeout, target out, and exit out. So you're either making money, losing money, or it times out. You know, you're in, out, or you come back tomorrow. And that really is the real secret to success. It's when not to trade, when to place the trade, how to manage the trade. As you just saw, it takes longer to explain than to actually do. But if you need some extra help and you want some handholding and, you know, help you build your trade confidence so that you can transition into that, you know, the best possible trader that you can be, without stressing over whether the market's going up or down tomorrow, without worrying about if they're going to crash, without worrying about the elections, without worrying about all the nonsense that's going on. If you want to do all of that and you need some help with it, then let's talk. I don't know if what we do is right for you until we have a conversation. I would invite you to send me an email, send it to phil@antivestor.com. And let's start the conversation. Let's see if what we do is right for you. If it's not right, that's okay. I'll put you off in the right direction. If it is right for you, then let's talk. Just let me know a little bit about your trading experience. And more importantly, if you've got time to do this strategy, because there's no point learning this if you haven't got the time. If you've not got at least about 45 minutes at the start of the day, then it doesn't make sense for you. But if you want to know and you're not sure, send me an email and we'll see if we can, at the very least, point you off in the right direction. For everyone else, if you're already in our inner circle, when I finished recording the step-by-step version of this program, it will appear in your members area. So if you're already in, then you'll get it, which is great. So just preempting the subsequent questions that will appear. So it will automatically appear in the members area. So folks, thank you very much for your time. Thank you very much for your attention. This was hunting for potentially explosive stocks, how we can scan for the better opportunities. A good trading platform is required. Most of them are pretty decent these days. I mean, TradeStation's got some really good built-in tools. I'm not an advocate for them. It's just a tool that I use. You can do similar things with some online tools like TradingView. You can do similar things with multi-charts. You should be able to do it with most of the broker tools that you have available. All the tools that I use do come as standard. So if you're using thinkorswim, again, you can emulate the same thing. It's not exclusive to TradeStation. I'm not doing anything that is bespoke or secret. It's just I'm making use of the tools that we have available. And you saw how I like to use mine like it's a spreadsheet, and you saw what I did. You can pretty much just scan. There's some built-in tools that will help you find some of these great candidates. But that's how I do it. Hunting for the best opportunities by looking for stocks that have started to take off like a rocket, and then see if we can jump on the shirt tails. That is essentially what we are doing with hunting for rocket stocks. Folks, thank you very much for your time. I can't believe it. I'm ahead of time for a change. I'm ahead of time. I usually run a little bit over. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your attention. It really does mean a lot to me when everyone gets involved. I can see all your comments there. Thank you very much. It does mean the world that you take an hour out of your day and spend it with little old me. So it doesn't go unnoticed. So thank you for your time and attention today. The recording will be available in the Slack community. So you'll have full access to that, whether you're free or on the member access. It'll be available for at least the next 24 hours. And if you want some further help, as I mentioned, if you want some help with this strategy, some personal attention, send me a message. You can send that to phil@antivestor.com. And if you we'll see if what we do is right for you. So with that said, thank you again for your time. Thank you for your attention. That was Rocket Stocks. I'm going to stay around for the next 5 or 10 minutes. I can see there's a few questions again, so I'll answer those. And if you have any extra questions, by all means, send them over to me. I'll stop the visuals. I'll stop talking, more importantly, but I'll be around. So I'll answer those questions that I can see about the strategy and get you your answers. So with that said, folks, have a wonderful weekend. I'll speak to those who are waiting for an answer in just a moment. And for everyone else, if you've got follow-up questions, just send a message in Slack, and I have a wonderful weekend. I'll speak to you all momentarily.